is beginning to rain, rain, rain to the voice of our Father. Sing, whosoever will come drink of this water, I promise to pour my spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky, it's beginning.
Hello, friends. This is Tex Marrs, inviting you to worship with us today at Bible Home Church, coming to you from Austin, Texas. Great to be with you again as we begin a new series in the Word of God. And we're going to really be examining a favorite subject of mine. Is there a conspiracy in the world today? More than that, we're going to be discussing and examining the ages-old conspiracy between man and God. You know, really, it's more than a conspiracy by men against God, because men in this conspiracy have the active aid and assistance of millions of devils from the pit. So, in effect, what we're going to be discussing over the next several weeks is the ages-old conspiracy between Satan's agents, whether they be demon or human, against God and His kingdom. Now, I want you to understand, a lot of people say, well, Tex, what are we supposed to do about this kind of information? Well, God, amazingly, doesn't give you a detailed scenario of what to do with your life. You can go to the Bible and, you know, there's just not a guide for what to do every day from the moment you wake up till the time you go to bed at night. And, you know, there doesn't have to be. First of all, we know that God has written His law on our hearts, if you belong to Him. A lot of people look to the Bible as a law book. And of course, there are principles, there are commandments, and you should obey those. Don't get me wrong. God hasn't negated His word. It's simply that those same guidelines are written on your heart. For example, the Ten Commandments says, you know, thou shalt, it begins with, thou shalt not worship other gods before me. But if you belong to Jesus, you already know that. It's written on your heart. There's nothing wrong with reading the Ten Commandments and studying them. But tell me the truth. Once you belong to Jesus Christ, didn't you really know He was the only one to be worshipped? The Ten Commandments tells us not to lie, not to kill. In other words, murder. But you already knew that. If you have the Holy Ghost inside of you, you've been sealed by the Holy Spirit of God, you know you're not supposed to murder. You think you have to have a book as great as it is, written by God, perfect in every way, tell you that? No, you already know those things. Friends, you know you're not supposed to commit adultery. You know you're not supposed to cheat people. You know you're not supposed to deceive. You know you're not supposed to defraud. You know you're not supposed to provoke your children by being cruel to them, by being unfair to them. You know you're supposed to treat your wife the way you want Christ and the way Christ does treat you. And husbands and wives, you know how you're supposed to treat your husbands. You know you're supposed to treat each other, in fact, with great respect and love and care and mutual admiration and trust. You know you're supposed to treat your neighbor as yourself. You know you're supposed to put God first in your life. You know there are things that God requires you to do. Friends, listen to me. The best way to ensure that you're living the life God wants you to, a joyous, prosperous life, is to live through God in you. Isn't that an amazing thing? You know, the Jews have these law books, the Talmud. Oh, they're in slavery and bondage. The Muslims have their various laws. They have all of the sayings of Muhammad written into what they call their hadith. And every religion seems to have its rules and regulations, most of them in writing. But God writes these things down in your heart. How do you know them? You just get up in the morning, and from the minute you wake up, my friends, you tell Jesus, "Please, Lord, live my life today for me. Show me what to do. Teach me. Guide me." And, you know, God will, in His great wisdom, will lead you to everything you're supposed to do that day. The steps of a righteous man or woman are indeed ordered by God, and He has already arranged the good works you are to do in advance for you. The people you're going to meet today, God has arranged it all. I ran into Sally by accident at the supermarket. No, you didn't. Wanda last night made a phone call to a friend, and she hadn't called her in a little while. Her name was Pat, the woman she was calling. And she was going to invite Pat over to do something or other. I don't even know what it was, over to the house. And she opened up her little Rolodex. You know, this is like this phone thing. You know, you just put the little dial thing and then push the button and it goes up to the phone number for a certain letter of the alphabet. And Pat's last name was Oyston, O-Y-S-T-E-N. So she pushed the little button on the O's to call Pat Oyston, and she looked at the phone number. But Wanda made a mistake, because the next person in line was somebody named Orsak, Linda Orsak. Oyston Orsak. And she accidentally called Linda Orsak's name, a phone number. And Linda answered, "Hello." And Wanda said, "Pat, is this you?" And Linda said, "Wanda, is that you?" And Wanda said, "Oh, Linda Orsak. Well, I haven't talked to you for a long, long time." Well, Linda said, "Well, why are you calling? Who's Pat?" "Oh, that's just another friend of mine," Wanda said. "I've been wondering how you're doing, you and your husband, Otto." And, you know, they got into a big conversation. And Linda said to Wanda, she said to her on the phone, now imagine, this wasn't planned at all. Wanda planned on calling somebody entirely different. She got in the directory, got the wrong number. It was just right. The two numbers were right there together, I'm sure. Suddenly she's speaking with Linda. She wanted to talk to Pat. She says, "What are you doing now, Linda?" Linda said, "Well, I've got a volunteer job. I'm going down to the Hayes County Jail, and they've assigned me 26 women down there in jail, and I counsel them." And Wanda said, well, how wonderful. And she said, "Oh, it's been a great ministry, Wanda." She said, "Right now I'm looking for some books and some tapes and some materials to give these prisoners, some Christian materials." Wanda said, "Oh, well, come on down to the ministry offices. We've got this wonderful Bible devotional guide, and we'll give you a several cases free of it. And we've got this wonderful book called The Blood of Christ, and we'll give you some of that. And we got God's Promise, little promise book, and then we got the Bible Student's Handbook, and we'll give you all of those on a missionary outreach program that we have." And Linda says, "Well, I don't have to pay for them." She says, "No, you can have them free. You know, if you're going to be trying to help people come to know Jesus." And Linda was just thrilled. She says, "Well, I'll come by the ministry offices." So now she has arranged to come by the ministry offices and pick up some free materials that we're going to give her for those women in jail. But it wasn't planned. Or was it? I think it was. I think Linda Orsak was probing in her mind, how am I going to get these materials? I need books. I need inexpensive Bibles. I need. Maybe she had prayed about it. And then the phone rang, and there was Wanda Morris to say, I've got books for you. I've got Bibles for you, free of charge. See how things work together for good to all those who love the Lord Jesus Christ? Friends, listen to me. I'm not saying everything works so miraculously as that does. But that was no accident, Wanda calling Linda Orsak. She got off the phone and said, guess who I just talked to, Tex? I said, yeah, I heard you. It was Linda Orsak. She says, yeah. And we talked about this and that and this. And she went on to tell me how she was doing. You see, friends, God has a destiny for you. On the other hand, there are those who despise God, who love evil, have rejected the truth. They're caught up in a web of bondage and deception. And you know, the devil puts them in touch with his people too, his agents. Just as God puts us together as Christians and arranges our lives, the devil arranges for like-minded evil people to come together as one to fight the things that are good in this world. There's no accident why evil men have banded together in a conspiracy. It's not some kind of a strange, fringe, weird, nutcake idea at all. It is the history of this world. And over the next few weeks, we're going to look at it from a scriptural perspective, this ages-old conspiracy between man and God. The devil is ever working to weave a spider's web network of evil. And he wraps his cloak around thousands of human beings and imbues them, that is, endows them, gives them, provides them, furnishes them with the weapons and tools they need to destroy the good of this world. But God has a greater plan. Regardless of the devil's ages-old conspiracy, God has a plan that he formulated before the beginning of the world. And he took into account everything the devil would do. Every foul trick, deception, cunning lie that the devil will throw against you, my friends, God already knew about it in advance. You think you've been tricked by evil? You think you've been surprised? No, God has it all in control. And that's what we're going to be talking about over the next few weeks. Now, we always have beautiful music. And if you got a comment to make, or some words of encouragement perhaps, or an idea that God's put in your mind, or a prayer need, a prayer request. Maybe you want Texe Marrs to know that you're praying for me. I need all the prayers that I can get. And I believe that I am on this mission that I'm on because of the prayers of the saint. There was a need for a Bible home church because of the great apostasy in the last days. You know, it says in the book of Amos that in the last days there will be a great famine throughout the earth, not of bread, but of the preaching of the Word of God. And this program goes across the world, and people are hungry. They're in famine, my friends. They cannot get enough of the Word of God. Not locally. You know, the Bible says that people will be so hungry, they will literally travel the oceans just looking for someone to preach the gospel. Isn't that astonishing? I believe in America today, people are so hungry and so desperate, so starved for the Word of God. They cannot find it preached in churches today. And they begin to twist and to turn in their mind and say, what can I do? And some run off into the devil's houses. Some go off into the New Age or the occult. Or they take up agnosticism or atheism because there's no one to preach to them, they think. Of course, if they simply prayed to the Lord, he would send them a messenger. I believe that. I believe anyone who prays and asks God to send them help, He will do it. Believe me, in His time. He's not some genie for you to command, do this and do that and give me what I want right now. But you pray, my friends, and be patient. Be patient. And God will do it. He will do it. And I believe that many have prayed, God, send me the Word of God. And then someone says, brother, you can hear the Word of God. Pastor Texe Marrs in Bible Home Church, he preaches the Word of God because he believes the Bible is inspired, is perfect, is without error, and that Jesus is still Lord, and every other god is a false devil. And he believes that you can trust in Jesus. 100%. And he believes Jesus Christ is coming again. And you know, a lot of people say, I want to hear that program. That's the program I want to hear. We don't tickle people's ears here. We don't try to make them feel good. We don't tell them we'll make them rich. We don't say, send this ministry a love gift of $100 and God will give you back $10,000. We don't tell you that at all. We say this, obey God and count the cost. But know this, there is treasure in His Word. And Jesus is that pearl of great price. All right, my friends, we have a beautiful song today. It's an old song, you know. You know, nowadays, people don't even talk about supper anymore. They talk about going to dinner. Well, back in the South where I came from a little town in East Texas. I guess you could call that the South. Some call it the Southwest. But the evening meal we used to call supper. Sometimes we'd go out and play, and then, boy, when we'd see that sun going down over the horizon, we might hear our old mom call out, supper time! And, boy, we'd come running. Well, here's a beautiful old song. It's a great old standard. I think you'll enjoy it. And then we've got a few minutes left today to begin our series on the ages-old conspiracy between man and God. This is Pastor Texe Marrs, again reminding you, you're listening to Bible Home Church. Now from the Gaither Old Friends album, you can get that at your Christian bookstores. Here's a wonderful tune you're going to love.
Shadows creep and fast.
indeed prophetic power in the Word of God. You know, there's a lot of prophets abroad throughout planet Earth. But I wouldn't put much stock in any of them who base their prophecies on something other than the Scriptures. You know, television all the time comes on with specials about Nostradamus, the French seer of many centuries ago. And yet, when you look at the quatrains of Nostradamus, there were a few amazing hits. But then there were also prophetic mistakes, let's just call them miscues. In other words, false prophecies by this French seer, Nostradamus. You know, friends, even a broken clock or a watch that's inoperative is correct at least twice a day. And so, not too many years ago, I was reading in the newspaper a study that was done of the forecast and predictions of the world's greatest astrologers, Gene Dixon and so forth. Amazingly, their predictions came true a less percentage of time than did those of just people chosen at random on the street. You see, what they did was they took the predictions of Gene Dixon and the other famous astrologers and psychics, and then they just took people at random off the street and said, would you predict something that you believe will happen this year? They found out that just the people picked off the street at random were able to predict the future greater than the astrologers. Now, if we're going to know the future, however, there is one sure way, and that is God's Word, the Holy Bible. We're going to talk about the future today, and yet we're going to talk about the past. You see, the past sets the agenda for the future. Did you know that Jesus was the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world? You say, how could that be? How could he be slain when the foundation of the world was laid? And as a matter of fact, Jesus was the one who laid the foundation of the world. Tex, you're talking about something that scientifically is impossible. Well, of course it is. Because science is a false methodology without knowledge. And, of course, God is the great scientist, the greatest of all time, the greatest that there ever will be or could be. And he sets his own agenda, his own time. We're more and more, of course, finding out scientifically that time is relative. Now, not morals. Man tries to make morals and religion relative. But God has certain absolutes. But when we get to the area of time, it is indeed relative. Einstein had some insight into that. E equals mc squared, that old equation, but powerful in its profundity at the time when Einstein came up with it, shows us clearly that time cannot be measured in the normal way that we measure it as human beings. But it depends on space and speed and other elements. Now, I'm trying to work into something today that's going to be very powerful for you to understand. You see, from the beginning of time, God even knew that the devil would rebel and revolt against him. You say, why didn't God stop it? Well, I don't know. I can't read God's mind. He did what he wanted to do. I've always been very pleased to just go along with God's plan. I've always been very pleased to do that. You know, a lot of people cannot accept things as they are, and they wish to change those things. You know, Satan himself would like to change things, would he not? He doesn't want to go. His destiny is the pit. He doesn't want to go there necessarily, but he cannot change his destiny. Judas betrayed Christ and went and hung himself. You say, well, surely that was a destiny he did not desire. Well, he may not have desired it, but he went and fulfilled his destiny. Why did he do it? Because at the Last Supper, Jesus looked at him and said, "Go and do what you have to do quickly." And Judas, being commanded so by the Lord Jesus, immediately got up and went and did his dirty deed. You see, my friends, God has set the parameters of your life and my life. Now, at the same time, he has set the parameters for what we would call the great world conspiracy of the last days. And these are facts. These are not theories.
If you're thirsty and dry, look to the sky. It's beginning to rain.
You've been listening to Pastor Texe Marrs and Bible Home Church. Please join with us in worship next week as we continue to honor the remarkable Word of God.
It's beginning to rain, 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 hear the voice of our Father, saying, whosoever will come drink of this water, I promise to pour my Spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky, it's beginning.
Hello, friends. This is Texe Marrs, inviting you to worship with us today at Bible Home Church, coming to you from Austin, Texas. We're not really promised that we'll be here at Bible Home Church. Now, why is that? Well, because Jesus might just decide to come again. And we may not be around. You know, so many people wonder when Jesus will come again. I do believe there's one great event to occur, and that's in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And I'm expecting it at any time. It says there that the great gathering of the saints will not happen until there first come a falling away. And then the son of perdition, meaning the Antichrist, is revealed. Well, we know we're in the midst of a great falling away. That's for sure. The lie has hit planet Earth big time. Now we're just going to be looking out for that son of perdition. Some say, well, Jesus could come before the Antichrist arrives. Well, he could do anything he wants, but he said he wouldn't, and that's why he's not going to. He said he wouldn't come, gather up the saints. Paul said, don't let anybody deceive you by any means. So if you hear prophecy teachers say Jesus Christ could come today, say, well, only if we discover the son of perdition being revealed. And that may occur in this 24-hour period, or it may not. But until then, one man told me, well, what you're doing is you're not looking for the return of Christ. You're looking for the return of Antichrist. Now, that's pretty silly. My friends, listen to me. There are certain signposts, things that must occur before Jesus returns. It doesn't mean we lack them. The fact that we're looking for the Antichrist to return, to come, not to return, for the Antichrist to show up, doesn't mean we lack it or that we're looking, you know, with anticipation. In fact, I look at it with a lot of trepidation because it's going to mean misery to so many people. But nevertheless, God said there would be a son of perdition. There will be an Antichrist. He will be a man, Revelation 13 says, and his number is 666. So that's the way it is. And Paul said, don't let anybody deceive you. Jesus will not return again until these two great events occur. The falling away and the coming of the son of perdition, who exalts himself above all. So we've got to be on the lookout for that. Jesus Christ says there will be many who will come and say, I am Christ. He said, believe them not. How do you know the true Christ? It's in the Bible. It's in the Bible. Why would there be an Antichrist come first? Well, Jesus said he sends his truth, but so many are going to reject it because narrow is the way and broad is the path to destruction. Narrow is the way to the true path of Jesus Christ. And you've got to enter in at that straight gate, my friends, or he won't accept you. And you know, the shepherd knows his sheep. If you're of someone else's fold, he'll throw you out. Jesus stated exactly that was what he was going to do. He knows his sheep, and they know him. I was recently reading where a Catholic priest, somebody sent me an article, and he was explaining how no one could really know that they're saved. No one will really know until we die and go to some other place. Then we'll know if we've done enough to get to heaven, or if we're in purgatory or down there below. Billy Graham said about the same thing when he was asked. He said, I really hope that I get to heaven, but I'm afraid I may go to that other place. I felt sorry for the man. He hopes he'll go to heaven, but he's afraid he's going to go down to that other place. Now, I don't know why he's afraid he's going to go down to that other place. Let me tell you something, friends. I'm not going down there. Am I better than Billy Graham? No, I'm not better than anybody. There's a lot of people better than Tex Marrs. A lot of people have done greater things than Tex Marrs. A lot of people are more pure in heart than Tex Marrs. I just praise the Lord that he saved me anyway. I guess he had pity on me. I don't know, maybe that day, you know, God looked down and said, today, just for fun, let me pick the most pitiful creature there is. Yeah, there's that Texe Marrs guy. I'll pick him today. That was my lucky day, friends. You know, sometimes you just don't know why God chooses you. You just better be thankful, and I am. But I'm not going to spurn it. I'm not going to say, well, I just don't know if God has chosen me. I just don't know whether I'm going to heaven or hell. You know, John said, we know that we are of God. And the whole world lies in that wicked one. What does it mean? John told the church, we know we are of God. Well, Tex, how can I know? How can I know I'm of God? Well, listen, if you are of God, you better quit doubting it. You're going to be in big trouble. I'm not saying you're going to lose your salvation. There are some people out there, they're just nervous Nellies. They're running around all the time. I just don't know if I'm saved. I just don't know if I'm going to get there. Well, you probably won't. You're probably not saved. And then there's a person, the first time they tell a little white fib or something, I'm sure they shouldn't have told it. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not trying to suborn sin. I'm not in favor of sin. But the instant that they commit the smallest of sins, and please don't write to me and say, Tex, a small sin is as big as a big sin. That's all baloney. Sin may be sin, but there are some big sins and some small sins. Okay? I'm sorry. There's some that have terrible consequences. And some you can just get by with, but that doesn't mean God didn't write it down somewhere. He knows about it. But some people believe the instant they commit the tiniest of sins, well, they're going to hell. I'm sure there's some precious sisters out there that if your girlfriend says, do you like my new blouse? They say, oh, it's delightful. It's divine. It's glorious. When they really don't mean it. Looks like a rag. Looks terrible. You're thinking all the time, where did you get that horrible piece of cloth? Or, ooh, what a terrible color. But you don't want to hurt your friend's feelings, so you say, oh, that's real nice. Is that a lie? Well, yes. I'm not going to be here all day trying to tell you how to finesse your friend or anything else. I'm going to let you figure that out between you and the Lord on what to do with those cases. But I will tell you one thing. There are some precious sisters who say, oh my goodness, that's a lie. I told a lie. I didn't want to hurt my friend's feelings, so I told her that blouse looked good on her. God's going to punish me. I'm going straight to hell. Well, now, God may do one, you know, some consequence there. There may be something. Maybe if you tell your friend every time, oh, yes, it looks great, she begins not to believe you anymore. That might be a consequence. You know, one, and I have to laugh. I have to tell you a little secret. She comes many times to me and says, do you like me in this dress? Or do you like this? Do you like this purse with these shoes? And, you know, I have to be very careful because, oh, I'm going to get in trouble just telling you good friends about it. But don't tell Wanda now. If you see her, we are out on some conference sometime and you see her, don't tell her I told you this. She's not in the room where I'm broadcasting this. But if she says to me, do you like this blouse? And I say, no, it doesn't look good on you. She goes, I say, well, don't get mad at me. You asked me the question. Well, you know, she says, I've tried to, this, I just don't have another blouse that goes with this skirt. Now I'm going to have to go wash something, or I'm going to have to, well, I'm saying, well, don't blame me one. I'm just a messenger. Don't ask me if you don't want to get the bad news. Now, 90% of the time I tell her she looks nice, because she does. Actually, she really is very, very talented. And I'm saying this now behind her back so she won't know it. She is very talented in how to dress and such. She chooses good color combinations and all of that. And she knows how to, well, she just knows how to dress. I guess some people come naturally by that. Well, Wanda does. But she doesn't like me to tell her she doesn't look good. And I have to be real careful the way I dress it. Sometimes I say, well, sweetheart, that looks good on you, but you know that gray blouse you have? That really looks nice. Why don't you wear that today? And man, that seems to work sometimes. Sometimes it doesn't, you know. But in any case, I don't know where I got off on a tangent on Miss Wanda, my precious wife, but I don't think God is going to send me to hell because I tell her she looks good in a certain blouse or I don't. But, you know, if I told Wanda every time she came to me and says, do I look good in this blouse? And I said, oh, yes, wonderful. Oh, marvelous. You know, she wouldn't trust my judgment very much. She'd say, you always say that. I can't trust you. She wouldn't believe me. It's probably good about one out of every 10 times I do find something wrong. Now she when I do tell her, no, I don't think that looks that good. No, I don't think those, that shade of color in those shoes looks good with that person. Now she believes me. She might grouse a little bit. I think it's just because it means more trouble having to go change or something. But she trusts my judgment, believe it or not. Well, not every time. Sometimes she says, well, thank you for your advice, sweetheart. And she's just so nice. I know she doesn't really mean it. She doesn't really thank me for my... And then she goes off and wears whatever she wants. Says, what do you mean, thank me for my advice? You didn't take it. She says, well, just because I didn't take it doesn't mean I don't appreciate it. She's pretty clever, isn't she? These ladies, guys, you got to, I tell you, wise. What does the Bible say there in Proverbs? Sandra, you're my broadcast engineer. It says she's worth her weight in rubies. Yeah, far above. That's far above, yeah. Well, that's for sure. So we have to appreciate them, guys, and just get in line and do whatever they want. You know, there's an old joke Wanda likes to tell, you know, about going to a dress shop one day, and she bought a dress. She came home, and I said to her, oh, how much did that cost? And she told me, and I said, oh, Wanda, boy, that really breaks our budget. You know, we were a little bit younger and struggling just a little bit. She says, well, I said, that really, boy, that's really over our budget. She says, well, I'm sorry, but the devil made me do it. I said, the devil made you do it? Wanda said, yes, the devil made me do it. She said, I just looked in the mirror, and I just looked at myself in that new dress in the store mirror, and then there was this little voice in my ear from the devil said, buy it, buy it. So I had to buy it. I said, well, Wanda, don't you remember what Jesus said? Get thee behind me, Satan. She says, well, I did. And he said, look good back there, too. Oh, I'm really going to get in trouble now. Right, Sandra? Oh, actually, she didn't say that at all. I made all of that up. And I hope God doesn't send me to hell for lying today. Well, I don't think he's going to. because he knows I'm just joking. And I think even God laughs sometimes. You know, it says in the Old Testament he's going to laugh at the calamities of his enemies. Isn't that amazing? The devil really thinks he's putting one over on us, tricking us and deceiving us. Baloney. It says that God will hold them in derision. He's going to laugh at them. Laugh at them. And I laugh at the devil myself. In fact, I don't really talk about the devil. I don't really give the devil a lot of attention. It's really not worth your time. Best thing is to major on Jesus and minor on the devil. That's sort of our motto here at Bible Home Church. Major on Jesus and minor on the devil. Don't forget the devil. Expose him. Unmask him. But just make sure you know who you want to need to emphasize the most, which is Christ Jesus. Well, we're going to continue our wonderful series today, the ages-old conspiracy between God and man. But first, we have a song. You know, it says in the Bible that we're going to be invited, that is, if you're of Christ Jesus, to a great supper. A wedding, in fact. It's a feast. It's a banquet. And I expect to be at that table. How about you, Sandra? Amen. Sandra says, you bet. Well, she didn't really bet. She means absolutely. I know her and her precious husband, Rich. By the way, does Rich compliment you sometime, Sandra? He does. That Rich is, he's a pretty clever fellow, and he's pretty smart. Yeah, he is. He says he is. Okay. All right. Okay. he is. Yeah, he's a good friend of mine. Rich, we sent Sandra, I always say, to Colorado, state of Colorado, on a tour. It was a conference, wasn't it? You went. That's right. We had like an expo there, and I was a speaker, and we had a little book table there and everything. Sandra went with Wanda and I, and I think, no, you went without Wanda and I. That's right. That was the trouble. We weren't there to keep you from getting in a jam. And that's right, she went there because we couldn't go and you were going to represent the ministry. So Sandra went, and that's where she that's right, yeah, then she met Rich Myers there, and they got married, and she ran off to Colorado for a while, and then we got her back here. We had to go up and convince her, talk to her, into coming back with us. I think that's the way it went, sort of, and she brought her husband back too. And now he's going to become a native Texan. There must be a time period there. Like 7 years you got to live in Texas before you become a true Texan, Sandra. He's about to reach that, I think. But we're trying to get that Colorado Rockies out of him, make him into a real Texan. This is a song by the Cathedrals, and it's about that wedding music. Listen up, friends. You can hear it. The wedding music. The marriage supper of the Lamb. It's being prepared right now, and you're invited. We're going to have this music now by the Cathedrals. The Cathedrals, one of the greatest gospel quartets of all time. And then we're going to continue with whatever time we have left today on our series.
Ladies and gentlemen, the reunion of the Cathedral Quartet.
this land of sorrowless men. For that ceremony in the air, the Father.
The British Broadcasting Corporation, the BBC. Now, that's sort of, for Great Britain, that's sort of like a combination of CBS, ABC, and NBC all rolled into one. It's their major television network over in Great Britain, and they want to fly over to the United States, and they want to interview me for an hour for some kind of a special series they're doing on conspiracy theory. They consider Tex Marrs one of the top experts in the world on conspiracy theory, and they're going to spend a lot of money to come over here and interview me. And I sent a very nice email back to the gentleman, the producer, and I said, well, please be aware that I do not believe in theories. And we're not into conspiracy theories. I'm not at all interested in theories. But if you would like to come and interview me on conspiracy fact, then I'll be glad to talk with you. I don't know what the gentleman probably thinks, that everyone who believes in conspiracy must be some kind of a wacko or a very strange person. And maybe that's the kind of program they're looking for on TV. I don't know. But you see, I don't want to play that silly game of theirs, because I believe in the Bible. And the Bible talks about and prophesies and forecast a conspiracy. A conspiracy that has occurred on this planet since the very beginning of time. That's right. There has always, let me emphasize this, there has always been a conspiracy on this planet against God and against man. We're going to talk about that today. And if you've never really looked into this area of conspiracy, because you feel like you may somehow be, if you start believing in this, you could be in trouble. You could, you know, have to run in fear for your life. Well, that may be so. I mean, to know the truth makes a man a target. There's no doubt about that. It is much better to run and hide. Now, if you're afraid that you might become a target by knowing the truth about the conspiracy that has existed since the beginning of time, that time at least that God has made for man's destiny here on earth, if you're afraid that you'll become a target of the government, a big brother, whatever, please turn off the radio at this time. I don't want to put you in jeopardy. You will be at risk because you will know. And when you know, of course, something, then you have a responsibility. Now, God doesn't necessarily, you see, hold you at fault if you're ignorant and you've never had an opportunity to know something. So if you want to stay dumb and stupid and ignorant, please turn off the radio at this time. I don't want to get you in trouble with the Lord either. Because, you see, once you know these things, He being the great master of us all, will probably require you to do something about it. And if you want to stay fat, dumb, and happy, or skinny, dumb, and happy, whichever is the case, well, you definitely do not want to listen to this program. Because we're going to be looking at the ages-old conspiracy against God and man. I say against God first because, you see, that's where it all began. It began in heaven when the devil rebelled, and one-third of the angels in their stupidity went along with his scheme, and they were cast out of heaven. The devil, or Lucifer, and those in revolution. And ever since, there has been a revolution against God's plan. And since God has a plan for mankind, that revolution has spread among men as they have been inspired by devils to do the work of their master, Lucifer. And this, then, is the very beginning. This is the font of trouble. It began in heaven. It is now spread to earth. Remember, when the Lord commanded the devil to report to him, that's in the book of Job, the Lord, very sarcastically, you say, now, Tex, the Lord would not be sarcastic. Well, really? He said to the devil, what have you been doing, Lucifer? And Lucifer says, I've been walking to and fro on the earth. Well, you know, the Lord already knew what the devil had been doing. But, you know, he even knows the desires of your heart, but he still expects you to pray to him. And he expected the devil, being just an errand boy. Did you hear me? Did you listen to me close? The devil is an errand boy. He's a pitiful, defeated character. And God required him to report to him. On a certain time or day, I don't know what that is in God's kingdom, because one day is as 1,000 years, God had his servants report to him. And the devil was one of them. Now, a lot of people may say, well, Tex, I don't believe that the devil is a servant of the Lord. Well, you just don't know your Bible. The devil is a prisoner. The devil has been defeated. And now the devil is going to continue his furious but short existence until he's thrown into the lake of fire. And you don't want to go there with him, friends. But believe me, it's not some kind of a heavenly contest going on. A lot of people think, well, you know, the devil and the Lord, they're in some kind of a nip-and-tuck battle. It's battlefield earth, battlefield heaven. Oh, there's just fighting going on all the time. Friends, the only battle is when God allows a battle to occur. I learned this a long time ago when I first began my ministry, because no sooner had I begun this ministry and began to preach the truth, then the devil began to attack me in ways that you wouldn't believe.
If you're thirsty and dry, look to the sky, it's beginning to rain.
You've been listening to Pastor Tex Marrs and Bible Home Church. Please join with us in worship next week as we continue to honor the remarkable Word of God.